We will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Martin Luther King would have been 63 on January 15th, and most of America celebrates his birthday as a tribute to his devotion to the American principles of brotherhood. But nearly a quarter century after his assassination, what sort of America are we becoming? What progress have we made and failed to make? That discussion this week on At Week's End. But first, this background report by Matt Snedden.
King celebration really understands that we are a diverse people, but yet we are a people who are able to gain real strength from that diversity that is ours. Much of what we share in the world today is a direct result of the effort to make men equal everywhere and for us to learn the importance of having respect one for the other. It was pretty rough. First of all, there wasn't a real consciousness of the disadvantagement of people of color. I think they were just seen as nobodies, if seen at all. The nation had to be brought to that consciousness so that we were not just objects, that it was understood that families needed the same things that other families did. Individuals needed education and good housing and good jobs. So when those things are missing, life is a struggle. People are more conscious today than they were before Dr. King. However, I don't believe that everything has changed. I think there's still a lot of work to do. And in some instances, I think that perhaps where we were, say, 10 years ago, there's been some retrogression. And maybe that comes because sometimes people do lose a consciousness of the need to move forward because there's a lack of continual emotion as it is related to what the issues are. During the days of Dr. King, we were constantly reminded of crises. Since many things have changed, we are not reminded that there are still some crises that may not necessarily be attached to color, but are a part of the needs of change for understanding what an American dream is, what the dream of Dr. King's was and is today.
Fight the power! Fight the power! Fight the power! We've got to fight the power!
I think that the Reagan years provided some feeling that now that there's no more Kennedys, no more Martin Luther Kings, no more leadership in the area where we try to change segregation, discrimination, even though many of those things still exist, I think people feel a license now to express themselves in those ways that perhaps during those years they feared because of government intervention, because of the government's intent, desire to change the image of America as it related to its race problems. That's not present now. That's not present with Bush. It wasn't present with Reagan. And people feel a little freer to express themselves and indeed to religiously follow after some of those things that were covered with the sheets years ago. don't have to cover them anymore. They're wide open.
I don't mind saying to you tonight that I'm tired of living every day under the threat of death. I have no martyr complex. I want to live as long as anybody in this building tonight. And sometimes I begin to doubt whether I'm going to make it through. I must confess I'm tired.
Reverend King was not only concerned with Negroes or black people, but he was concerned with the condition of the world, and that included all people. Those of us who are blessed to be around today still need to look well at what he sought to do, and we need to carry that torch because the job is not finished, and we're the persons that can bring it about.
We will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Joining me now are three distinguished guests, each with a special perspective on the legacy of Martin Luther King. Dr. Shimi Okunor is a native of Ghana and professor of African-American studies at the University of New Mexico. Richard McCord, for 15 years, was editor and co-publisher of the Santa Fe Reporter, winner of several national journalism awards, and now a freelance writer. And Debbie Jaramillo is a native New Mexican, a Santa Fe businesswoman, and a Santa Fe city councilor. Welcome to all of you.
Thank you.
Dr. Okunor, let me ask you first to give us, if you will, a brief capsule of what progress have we made since Martin Luther King? What can we point to as the positive legacy of this remarkable man?
It's always very difficult to answer such questions because one can pick one or two items and point them as progress, and yet one can pick three or four and point at them and say there has not been any progress. I think the speech that we just saw is apropos right now, and that speaks to the conditions of all people presently. And I like to think if the speech is still apropos, then we haven't made that much of a progress. I can also say, though, that there's progress because probably there's a new vocabulary now, diversity. And when people say for diversity, they're talking about equal opportunity for all and that workplaces and schools should reflect the complexion of society, so to speak. That may be a progress, but maybe a small one. There is probably dozens and dozens of procedures and policies and businesses and also governmental policies that probably speak to the need to diversify the workforce. That may be a progress, but I'm not sure whether those are progress. I think if you go down to the core of what really people need to exist and to for the pursuit of happiness, one may have mixed feelings to say there has been any kind of progress.
Dick McCord, you grew up in the South, a South pre-Martin Luther King. The South of the 1990s, a very different place. It's been brought into the nation economically. Its attitudes presumably are different. That's a kind of revolution in itself, isn't it? Regardless of this pro and con view of the legacy for black people.
It strikes me as truly a revolution when I compare the South today with the one I grew up in. And if I need to admit it, I'll say when I was growing up there, I just took it for granted, and I thought it was never going to change. I just thought this is the way it is. And what I see now in terms of progress for black people, I think the progress has been dramatic. I think that politically, educationally, in terms of role models, in terms of a middle class, in terms of voting, that this progress has been overwhelming, and it's still, in my opinion, probably the greatest social achievement that America has made in the last 20, 30, or 50 years. Now, I quickly want to say, to add, that I think we have an enormous way to go. I think we've almost succeeded one generation of problems regarding race with a new generation of problems, but I can still look back and say that I think we've come an enormous way since since the days when Martin Luther King started doing his making his movement.
Unthinkable when you and I were youngsters that black people would occupy the positions they occupy in the athletic world, in entertainment, and as you say, the emergence of a middle class that was only a dream in Martin Luther King's generation.
I heard one phrase. I went to a conference in Atlanta a couple of years ago, and one of the speakers, who in fact was running for mayor, he used a beautiful way to describe it. He said the civil rights movement presented admission to those blacks who held a ticket for admission, mm-hmm. for someone who had an education, for someone who had ambition, for someone who had the support of a family, for someone who had some finances behind him or her. Then all of a sudden they were able to be given admission, whereas before then they were not even given admission. They were just turned away at the door.
I have to say, though, Debbie, coming to you here, that not all of this record is very bright. We've alluded to that. Let me give you, however bleakly, a few statistics which I assembled here. This is the legacy, too, of these last 30 years. 30% of all black families now in this country living below the federal poverty line. The infant mortality rate among black people is 50% higher than among whites. The chief cause of death for young black men is murder in this country. Blacks have hypertension and strokes at twice the rate of whites. 30% of poor black families were headed by women when Martin Luther King made that speech. Today it's 70%. When he made that speech, 15% of black births were out of wedlock. Today it's 57%, five times higher than whites. 42% of black babies illegitimate. 89% now teenage pregnancies in the black world. I mean, these statistics go on and on. 50% of all our male prisoners in this country are black. We've created in these 30 years not only a legacy of civil rights and of great achievement, but the makings of a permanent and disastrous underclass in America. What's your thought about that?
Well, one thing I always remember that Dr. King preached was that civil rights and economics go hand in hand. And I think that we can see that while there have been those gains over the years for black people, if economics are to be a controlling factor, we can see that that is not prevalent in the black community and minority groups. Other statistics that I have been privy to are some where it applies to black children and how 3 out of 5 of black children are living in poverty. And, you know, while the country can boast about providing 8 million jobs over the last 10 years, they have been what are considered, you know, the poverty level income jobs. We have created a class of what is known as the working poor. And I believe that, again, you know, this is not only applicable to the black community, but to minority groups in general.
Let me ask you all, how much of this is a factor of race, or is it of class and economic structure in the United States? Are we intent on keeping black people down, or are we intent on simply keeping poor people down in this country? What's your reflection, Dr. O'Connor?
It's probably both, because most poor people are black. Or minority, so to speak. So even if you use class as the analysis, it falls into racial analysis. Now you can, and all the things that my distinguished friend cited in terms of the progress in the South, you can offset that by what is happening in the North. The North used to be the font of knowledge and where liberal ideas were predominating then. Now it's more segregated in the North than the South. So as we gain in the South, we lose in the North. So it is status quo. So there hasn't been any kind of progress. And I think I agree with you that probably those people who had the ticket were allowed in. But again, it wasn't too long ago when we were told that at least when you were allowed in, you had a glass ceiling. Mm-hmm. How far you can go. So the same thing, even though we can say, yes, there's some kind of a progress, there's a tremendous amount of non-progress or status quo. So the jury is still out in terms of whether we have done anything at all.
And a mass number of people who are being left behind, being left out of this process, economically and socially. Dick McCord, Was this a failure of legislation? Did we not? We used to think that if we could legislate the right of a black person to have lunch at a lunch counter, or to vote, or to live in an apartment next to a white person, that would be enough. And obviously, it hasn't been enough in America in the 1990s.
Well, I think that probably more laws, more attentive laws, could still be conjured up. But I think back when the nation was passing all these laws, the promise fell far, far short. I do feel that a glass ceiling is not as terrible as maybe a stone floor, because there was a day when a black person could not even, you know, get up through the floor. Mm-hmm. Now there are certainly limits on how far most black people can aspire to rise in corporations, and not so much in government, because government is more responsive, I think, to the will of the people, the quirks of the electorate, that kind of thing. But I totally agree with you. I think that there are invisible barriers that are extremely real against the rise of black people or most minority people. I don't know if a new set of laws could do that much about it. I'd have to rack my brains for the answer.
Well, these laws did not empower people as we once thought they would. They perhaps swept away obstacles, but they did not at the same time give people always the opportunity or the power to take advantage of that new legality.
It did. But then people started to redefine the meaning of those laws. Mm-hmm. Affirmative action was pretty good. Mm-hmm. But then people started talking about affirmative, redefining the terms of it. Some people would say, and I've said that so many times, I'm aware, I'm sensitive, yes, I'm all for affirmative action, but... And then
so they there's start been, a, been a kind of backlash.
That's right,
here.
They start talking about reverse discrimination. Another myth that really was really prevalent then, that we used to call people who were racist, that they were ignorant, they weren't educated, and as soon as they are educated, exposed to the information and all that, turn out to be a myth. Mm-hmm. Some really well-educated intellectuals who have published materials turn out to be people who... So whether we need laws or procedures, I'm not very sure. Probably it has to do...
Debbie, that raises a question. Racism, it seems to me, is alive and well in America. It's got a presidential candidate. It has a number of votes out there. It doesn't only affect black people. It obviously affects Hispanics. It affects people of color all over the United States. What's your sense as someone who grew up in New Mexico and experienced these last 30 years, the Civil Rights Revolution? How did it translate for Native Hispanics in this state?
Well, see, it's true. Racism is alive and well. And what has transpired over the last 20, 30 years is that it has... Today we are looking at more of a subtle racism, polite prejudice, if you will, while we have laws on the books that say you can't do certain things, we cannot legislate the morals of people, and we still have to deal with beyond the law, is what I guess I'm trying to say, is that, you know, even in, you can look to your own hometown, and I know that growing up in my hometown and in the state of New Mexico, we still have a great number of poor. We still have a great amount of racism. And the laws that have been on the books for years have done nothing to alleviate that problem. I think that it's going to be up to the people, as Dr. King tried to empower the people, to stand up, speak out, and do what is necessary. Of course, you know, he stood for nonviolent means by which we can participate and make the laws work for us.
I wonder if, in a way, ironically, if civil rights progress hasn't made it easier to be complacent about these issues. If you see a black face on television as a newscaster, if you see a Magic Johnson as a celebrity, if you see a black politician or an Hispanic legislator or an Hispanic governor, easier perhaps to ignore how much is yet to be done.
I think that's a really good point. I think that definitely does happen, partly because it's partly true. There are people of minority groups and people of color who have achieved very dramatic things, and there are others coming along behind them. Whereas in the past, we could all look at it and in total shame and say that every opportunity has been denied these people. But then, as you suggest, the bad side of that coin is then we just relax and say, mm-hmm. look, we have politicians, we have entertainers, we have school superintendents. Therefore, it must be working. There, we don't have prejudice.
Let me ask you all, we haven't resolved the basic issue of race and of human dignity that convulsed this nation for more than a century, brought us to civil war. We acquired in the last decade 9 million new immigrants in this country, 40% of whom are Asian. We've got a whole new rainbow here of new Americans, a new culture. How are we going to absorb this even more complex, even more varied, even richer mix of people when we're still struggling with that earlier absorption? Any thoughts about the future of America as a multicultural, multiracial society?
The first signs of people trying to deal with this is the change in the vocabulary. As I was saying from the beginning, the word multicultural, and diversity and all that, that's the first sign. But and yet still, the atmosphere is also ripe for people who are speaking out mm-hmm. vehemently against any kind of integration, saying some people should go to where they came from, and people make you feel uncomfortable if you're not of a certain hue, so to speak. So I'm not sure whether there's anything, but to some extent, one would have no choice but to find a way to deal with this situation.
But we're back to this economic element. So much of the competition for jobs so much of the juxtaposition residentially is among the minorities. Mm-hmm. who are facing these problems with the dominant white culture, so that black people are pitted against Koreans or Asians. You've got Hispanics who are concerned about the incursion of other minorities coming in. It's a kind of divide and conquer once again. Yeah. Debbie, how do you see that in New Mexico?
Well, I think, again, maybe perhaps that applies to the term unity mm-hmm. of people, of man. And while we are forced sometimes into being competitive with each other, I think that we can alleviate that problem by becoming more united, because when we talk about controls, and if you just look nationwide, when you talk about what is it that the richest 0.5% of America's families controls 35% of the nation's wealth, you know, well, you start coming down home and looking locally and see where the controls are. Then you apply that to where the problems are in town or at home, and I think it's just a matter of bringing it all together. You know, I mean, it's a very complex situation. I don't think that being competitive for the lower paying or the lower part of the bracket is going to solve anything. But
don't we need a massive infusion here of leadership? I mean, Martin Luther King made an incredible difference by being a leader, by articulating dreams and by getting into the street and by doing something. We seem to be absent that leadership in the 1990s at the national political level. The world has changed enormously in those 30 years. Where are the leaders, Dick? What do we need to translate what Debbie suggests?
Well, what Debbie said really did stir a memory once again from this conference in Atlanta that I referred to earlier, where for 3 or 4 days all the speakers were talking about the consequences of the progress or lack of progress in race relations. And the suggestion there, I don't know who the leader is going to be, and I'm not sure how soon such a leader might come along. But the strong suggestion there is the lack of racial progress and the lack of minority advancement that is undermining this whole country's competitive position in the world. Mm-hmm. That as long as we have a permanent underclass, as long as we have generation upon generation of people who never receive an education, who don't become skilled workers, who cannot compete with the Europeans or the Japanese, that the decline of this country is just going to continue and continue. And I think if anything is going to ultimately catch the attention of our leaders, It's going to be our economic decline in the world and the ongoing recession and the loss of jobs and the things that are stirring up the people already.
I have to respond that this American racial problem, this curse, has its parallel, of course, in the world, in the third world. Mm-hmm. We are surrounded by poor nations. 11 million kids die every year of preventable disease and hunger. We've got 200 new corpses every minute in the third world. The international equivalent of this underclass in the United States, which surrounds us.
We go straight back to what Debbie was saying. Some of those third world countries have gold, diamond, bauxite. Who's mm-hmm. mining all those gold, diamond, bauxite? Who's mm-hmm. ripping all these resources out of the country? So we go back to sometimes the economy. I cannot really help but to also say that sometimes we wait for leadership, and yet the leader, most times what they say we already know. So why shouldn't we? Why should we keep on waiting for
Dr. leadership? King didn't wait, did he?
That's right. He didn't wait.
He took to the streets.
That's right.
Yes. Let me ask you.
Another speaker at this conference, it seems like all my memories are coming from it, but it was a powerful conference. One of the speakers predicted that in the lifetime of, say, our children, you know, the children of people our age, there could be riots in the street, that the growing despair in the central cities and the growing lack of progress could actually lead to a dangerous situation for the children or grandchildren of the privileged class that doesn't seem to care about these issues right now.
Danger, disgrace, and opportunity at the same time. Thank you all. I want to have you back and perhaps chart some more hopeful progress at some point. Thank you, Dr. Shami Okuner.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Dick McCord, and thank you, Debbie Jaramillo. And thank you for joining us. We hope you'll reflect on the meaning also of Dr. King's All God's Children. For at Week's End, this is Roger Morris.